Do I need to know everything before I start in the role of a network engineer? What's the difference between hourly versus salary? What's the difference between a contract employee versus a full-time employee? Will I be building networks from scratch? What if I don't know the answer? Hey, in this video, I'll be sharing what are the five things that I wish I knew when I started as a network engineer. So for number one, do I need to know everything before I start in the role of a network engineer? So unless you're an independent contractor, and this is all from my experience, unless you're an independent contractor, there is no need for you to know 100% of everything that you need to do as a network engineer before you pursue that role. Now, it might help to get some exposure in whatever role you're in, just to get a general idea of what they do, but you don't need to know everything. When you come on board into the role of a network engineer, you're gonna get trained in exactly what it is you're gonna be doing. So definitely try not to sweat it there. Certs, when you pursue those and they teach you how to configure things like EIGRP, OSPF, is to get you familiar with the concepts of how things work. But don't take it to the level that on day one, you're going to be expected to build some sort of network. It's not the case. Moving on to number two. And that is, what's the difference between hourly versus salary? So with hourly, you're getting paid per hour, and it's usually at a higher rate than you would if you were being paid salary. And what that means is, for every hour you put in, I mean, that's how much you're getting paid. So you have the potential of, you know, getting, not only are you getting paid at that higher rate per hour, but you're also, your hours for that week may vary. They could go over 40 hours a week, which means you lean into some overtime, which is more money in your pocket. Or they could be a little less than that. So it's not as stable as if it was salary. So with salary, you're going to be paid at a set amount, 40 hours per week. So you may put in more hours at the office than 40 hours, but you're only getting paid for 40 hours that week. So why is that bad? Why is that good? For one, it's fixed. You know exactly what you're going to be getting every week or every 2 weeks, however you're being paid. And not only that, but you're not being paid hourly because it's already set. Every so often you get paid this much. Well, that means if you took a sick day, you know, that wouldn't hurt your pocket as it might if you were being paid hourly, where if you don't clock in that 8 hours for that day, well, now you're down 8 hours worth of pay. Number three, what's the difference between a contract employee versus a full-time employee? This is one of the questions I was like, you know, I didn't really pay much attention to it when I got started. I'm just like, $25 an hour, just sign me up, you know? And this is based on my experience once again. So my experience as a contract employee, the training process was really fast paced. It was about 2 weeks of training, and then I sort of just got thrown into the wolves, and it was sort of a learn as you go environment. Usually in that contract role, my rate, my hourly rate was a bit higher than if I was to be employed full time. But it still falls back to that whole setup, hourly versus salary. So usually if you're contracting, you're going to have an hourly rate. Whereas if you're full time, you would have a salary pay. My experience with full time would be there's a much slower onboarding process. A company really invests more time and energy and resources into making sure that you're brought up to the pace that you need to be in order to perform at the level the company expects you to. Outside of the onboarding process, you're also given benefits like dental, paid time off, which is great, and many other perks that can be included in those benefit packages. Hey, if you're enjoying this video so far, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. It'll really help support the channel, and smash that like button as it'll help and notify YouTube to spread this video to more people. All right, getting back to number four, will I be building networks from scratch? I was curious about this one. And I was like, I don't know if I could handle that pressure coming in out of the gate, just, you know, setting up a network. But here's the thing that I discovered through my experience as a network engineer, as a contract employee, a full-time employee, and an independent contractor. Remember, in the role of an independent contractor, you're sort of expected to know exactly how to do everything you need to do to complete a job. But in the role of, say, just being a full-time engineer or starting as a contracting engineer, you're likely going to be that whole building the network that's likely going to be already designed by the design team. As well as in terms of implementing those networks, you're likely going to reference a project that was done in the past. So you're not just building everything from the ground up. And that just helps keep a bit of consistency and structure in the overall projects of implementing those networks. But definitely lose the nerves there, as you don't need to know it all when you get started in terms of building these networks from scratch. So number five, and this was another big question I had, what if I don't know the answer? Like, who can I ask for help? Like, if I'm troubleshooting something, am I the last resort? Where do I go from there? So it's really important to know that the troubleshooting doesn't stop at you. If you happen to hit a wall on not knowing something, you can always reach out to your colleagues, your teammates, your manager, and need be, depending on where you are, there may likely be a team that you can escalate the troubleshooting to, whether that's senior engineers that work in another group, or whether that comes down to software development. So definitely don't bang your head against the wall thinking that if you can't solve it, that the issue won't go unsolved, but definitely understand that you have those resources to pull from that can help you to, you know, find the answer and dig a bit deeper to figure out what the underlying issue is. All right, well, that is the end of this video. I hope you found this video helpful towards your IT journey. If you did, consider smashing that subscribe button, as I'll be posting networking tutorials and helpful tips that you can use to excel in your IT journey. As always, thanks for viewing, and I'll see you on the next one.